Hey everyone, today I want to do a little bit different than usual. Today I want to talk to you about something that I love, science and engineering. In fact, if you didn't know this, outside the YouTubeverse, my real life, I'm an engineer. That's my job. And so as an engineer, my job really is to find solutions to problems. And today I want to find a solution to a problem with you. The problem I want to look at is, how long is a piece of string? Ever wondered that? Ever heard that? Well, today we're going to have a look. The first answer to that question, I guess, is, as an engineer, almost every question gets answered with, well, that depends. So let's have a look. What does it depend on? Science and engineering, find what it depends on.
Well, it depends on multiple factors, but for me as an engineer, the most important question is, how accurate do you need it? And at that point, I want to introduce two types of measurements, qualitative measurement and quantitative measurement. So let's get right into it.
Okay, let's get right started into qualitative measurement. Qualitative comes from the word quality, which means, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, a distinctive attribute or characteristic possessed by someone or something.
It basically means they tell you whether something meets a certain criteria or it doesn't. For example, how long is this piece of string? It is long enough to wrap around my finger. Or how long is this piece of string? It is shorter than I am tall. Now this might not seem very useful on the first look, but the reason they're attractive is because they're usually easier to find than quantitative measurements. And if they are enough, then you can save yourself some work. Also, they're binary. That means either true or they're false. So there's no ambiguity or precision in your measurement. But let's look into quantitative measurements.
Okay, so quantitative measurements, quantitative, comes from the word quantity, which is defined as the amount or number of a material or abstract thing not usually estimated by spatial measurement. Basically, it means a specific number of something like two dogs or three houses.
The biggest difference between a qualitative and a quantitative measurement is that the quantitative measurement consists of two elements. Those two elements are the value and the unit.
The value is a number, and the unit can be anything that we collectively agree on to compare something to, like apples and oranges. Yes, colloquially, you're not supposed to compare apples and oranges. But as long as you set your units correct, you can compare lots of things between apples and oranges. You can compare their mass, their size, you can compare the number of atoms they consist of, you can compare loads of things between apples and oranges.
Okay, but back to a piece of string. How long is this piece of string? Well, we don't really know. But let's try something together.
If we put something of known size beside it, like my thumb for example, then all of a sudden the size can be compared to the thumb. Then we just count how many thumbs it takes to line up, and we find out that this particular string is 10 thumbs long. So that means our value is 10 and our unit is thumbs.
Okay, so but the only reason I can do that is because I know the size of my thumb. But my thumb is not the same size as your thumb. So we need to find something that is the same to all of us, no matter where we are, no matter who we are, no matter what time it is. And that's not an easy task, is it? But let's look into history to see how humans have come up with measurement units like the meter that we have today.
Little disclaimer, I'm not planning on a history lesson. We are going to talk about where these came from, but a lot of details have been left out or simplified for the sake of understanding. But feel free to leave a comment if you feel like something very important was missed off. Okay, let's go back to the very early beginnings that we know of, where units of measurement were used. The first time that we know that measurement units were used were as early as 4000 to 3000 BC in Mesopotamia, Egypt, and other locations across the globe. So in Mesopotamia, for example, we've been able to decipher that they had measurements for length, distance, area, volume, mass, and time. We know what they were called, how they were written in script, what they mean, but we can only guess as to how it relates to our modern measurement units today. So let's jump right ahead forward to 1215, where we have records like the Magna Carta, in which King John of England proclaimed in writing,
"There shall be one measure of wine throughout our whole realm, and one measure of ale, and one measure of corn, namely the London quart, and one width of dyed and russet and hauberk cloths, namely two ells below the selvage."
And although you might not know what a London quart is, or what two ells below the selvage means, they're actually quite close to what a lot of people in the UK and the United States still use today. The second part of that statement is saying all cloths sold across England would have the same size, namely 2 ells, which is known today as 2 yards.
So, but if you've paid attention with your engineering mind, you will have noticed that there's still the big open question: how did they know what an ell or a yard was? And that's a very good question, and they did something very clever for the time. They used something that most people had available, which was limbs on their body. So what they referred to as a yard was the length you can stretch a bow, or a foot, which was the size of a foot, as the name suggests, or an inch, which is the thickness of a thumb. And they compared that, which was clever at the time. But I really hope this sounds ridiculous to you today, to go to a store and say, "I want 1 yard," and if you've got a really tall person, their yard is much longer than if you've got a short person with short arms. Or if you've got somebody with big feet, then their foot is different size. That would not be acceptable today anymore. But for the time, it worked all right. The rules that the Magna Carta established worked fairly well within England, and they had similar systems in most of the countries. But the problem started to arise when global science, engineering, and research started to cooperate, and they hit the issue of several different units for the same measurement, often even named the same.
Think of the gallon that is still being used today as a measurement for volume in the UK and the US. But even to this day, the US gallon actually refers to a different volume than the UK gallon. And if that doesn't cause confusion, then I don't know what does. And this basically happened all over the world when they started to exchange data with each other for science and engineering purposes.
So several countries agreed on a single system that they would use together, so that if they share any data, there's no dispute over what data represents.
So in the 1800s, they already used a system in Europe called CGS, centimeter gram second system, where those three unit, centimeter, gram, and seconds, were standardized. But with more electricity entering the world of engineering, they were looking to add standards for those electrical units as well. So in 1889, they superseded the CGS system with the MKS system, the meter kilogram second system, which would eventually evolve into the international system, which was published in 1960. And the name of this international system is, well, very uncreatively, International System, or SI, from the French Systeme International. But most people in the English-speaking world refer to it as the metric system. So what is the metric system really? Let's dive in and have a look. The metric system is a system controlled by a few groups that define the standards and what the units within the system mean. There are 7 different base units. Ampere, for electrical current. Maybe you've heard of the term amps you can get from your mobile phone charger. That's short for ampere, named after the famous mathematician and physicist André-Marie Ampère, who is considered the father of electromagnetism. Second one, candela, for light intensity, which is literally named after candle, as it is the light intensity of roughly 1 candle. The proper definition is a bit trickier to understand, but for now that is good enough. But let me know in the comments if you're interested in learning more about light values like candela, lux, lumen, and how they relate to each other. Third one, Kelvin, for temperature. And we could have a whole session about temperature measured units as well, but for now let's stick with Kelvin. And please don't say degree Kelvin, because Kelvin is an absolute temperature value, so just Kelvin. Fourth one, kilogram. Kilogram is interesting because it was the last one to be defined by anything other than a physical object. Fifth one, meter, for measurement of distance. And that one we will focus on in a bit more detail, because that is what we will need to measure how long our string is. Sixth one, mole, for amount of substance. That one is used in chemistry, and if you know what it is, then I don't need to explain it. And if you've never heard of it, then I won't be able to fit an explanation into this video either. But again, if this is something you'd like to hear more about, then leave a comment below, and I'd love to make another video for this. And last but not least, second, for measurement of time. This is the one that scientists can measure most accurately, the time of recording. I assume that all of you know what a second is, so I'm not going to go into detail and explaining. So now we've got our base units, and they are called base units because, as far as we know, they can't be broken down into other units. The SI also has derived units made up of those base units, like velocity or speed, which is distance over time. And because distance is meter and time is seconds, the derived unit for velocity is simply meters per second. And so using those base units, other physical properties can be measured, and units for them can be derived from the base units. But the SI standard offers an even more incredible concept. The main reason, I believe, why it is so much superior to the old imperial units. Scaling of units using prefixes. Prefixes means something that comes before something else. In the terms of the SI, that means a set of defined terms that, if put in front of a unit, scales that unit. Here is a table of all the officially defined terms. You probably heard of some of them, you probably have not heard of other ones. When it says 10 to the power of a number, that means 1 and that many zeros. So 10 to the power of 24 means 1 and 24 zeros. This basically allows you to scale up to really, really, really large numbers, as well as to really, really, really small numbers, without having to invent new units like the imperial system did. And the relationship between those big and small units is the same for meters, or ampere, or candela, or mole. It's always the same. Kilo always means 1000. Okay, we've seen now what the prefixes in the SI standard are, but I hinted earlier that this is what makes it so much superior to the old imperial system. And now I want to show you with a few examples. How many yards are in a mile? 1,760 yards in a mile. How many meters are in a kilometer? 1 kilo means 1,000. That means there's 1,000 meters in 1 kilometer. That seemed easy enough, but let's have a look at how many yards are in 3.658 miles. And while you figure that one out, I will tell you that there are 3,658 meters in 3.658 kilometers. I did promise you a bit more detail on the definition of a meter, so that's what I'm gonna give you now. 1889, they created a metal bar that they defined as having the length of 1 meter. But the problem with a physical object is, no matter how well you keep the temperature and humidity and everything else in its environment constant, the size of that object is not constant. It will change over time. Today, meter is defined as the distance that light travels in 1 divided by 2,997,92458 seconds. This number is not random. In fact, it's the speed of light. So using the universal constant of the speed of light and the already universally constant definition of seconds, they were able to define the meter universally constant.
Hi guys, I'm back one last time. So we've taken a bit of detour, learned where the units that we know today for measuring came from. But now I want to take you back to the original question. How long is a piece of string? Well, we've learned how long a meter is, which is exactly the distance light travels in 1 divided by 2,997,92458 seconds. We know what a millimeter is, which is a thousandth of that. And now we have measuring tapes that are exactly calibrated to that. With that, we can measure it. Now you might say, I could have done that 20 minutes ago. I know exactly what a meter is and I know what a measuring tape is. And I agree, that's very true. But I hope this video has given you a bit of appreciation for the hundreds of years of ingenuity, science and engineering that have gone into actually making it possible to have a meter. That's the same across the universe. And with that, I want to leave you. So how long is a piece of string? Well, that depends. Trust me, I'm an engineer.